I want to share this morning on a great subject, I believe, subject of love. Love is the language of heaven. How many people know that? Love, I believe, is awesome. It's an amazing subject. We've been sharing a lot lately, and I believe it's very, very important that we've been speaking about the power of God and the gifts of God. We've been talking about how to cast out demons and it's healing the sick, etc. And I really, really believe that it's very... How many people know that we must know who we are in Christ? We've got to know who we are in Christ. We've got to know the power of God. I do not believe for 1 minute that Jesus started a denomination. He started a church. I don't believe for 1 minute that God wants the church to just be a social event. He wants an army of people, an army of believers that know who they are, know the power of the gospel, know that we are children of the Most High God, that no weapon formed against us can prosper, that we can triumph over every work of the enemy. But I believe also that we've got to know that we are to live by love. Amen? So let's read the love chapter, 1 Corinthians 13. I know you all know it so well, but we're just going to read it again and have a bit of a bo peep here at the Word of God. Father, we do thank you for that. Amen? Wonderful Word of God. So we've been talking about, it says, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I have become a sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I can remove mountains, and have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. Love suffers long. Praise God for that. Amen. And is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. It is not puffed up or arrogant. Does not behave rudely. Does not seek its own. Is not provoked. Thinks no evil. Does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in truth. Bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. Amen? So I believe that there's something there that God really wants us to understand. What does it really mean to be able to just love? Because, you know, we want to be able to move in the Spirit. We want to be able to live in victory. We want to be able to, you know, the Bible does say, forget not all of the benefits. Bless the Lord, O my soul. And there are a lot of benefits. But I believe that God also wants us to understand that as Christians, He wants us to flow and move and walk in a particular way that's going to really affect people around about us. I don't believe that God just wants us to love everything and neglect the gifts. I think it would be a little bit lopsided if we just you know, had that funny sort of love. But I believe that whatever we do must be birthed in love. Amen? Whatever we do must be birthed out of love. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, it says, pursue love and desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. For he who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to God. For no one understands him. However, in the Spirit he speaks mysteries. But he who prophesies speaks edification, exhortation, and comfort to men. He who speaks in tongues edifies himself, but he who prophesies edifies the church. Then he says, I wish that you all spoke with tongues, but even more prophesied. So there's something there about the moving in the Spirit. There's something about you know, having the power of God, but also understanding that whatever we do must be done in love. John 3:16 obviously is a verse that every Christian knows. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Jesus came to this planet to fulfill the requirements of the old covenant. Jesus came with a desire, and he came out of love. God sent Jesus onto this planet not just so that he could do this or that, but so that he could display his love, so Jesus could come and fulfill the requirements of the covenant, of the old covenant, which he did in an amazing way. Do you believe that? with its requirements, with its priesthood, with its atonement, the sacrifices and law. At the same time, he came to establish a new covenant, a better covenant. He came to fulfill the old, and he came to establish a new covenant based on a perfect redemption. Instead of atonement, the blood of bulls and goats, but he came to give us a new creation reality, a new creation revelation with a new priesthood, with new sacrifices and a new law. In John 13, verse 34 to 35, Jesus speaking, he said these words. He said, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another." Jesus is coming to try to establish something that by nature, human nature does not really want to embrace that. Because you see, human nature naturally is very, very self-centered. Would that be correct? We live for self, we want to please self, we want to just look after ourselves. But now Jesus comes on the planet, and in reality what he's doing, he's bringing something new in. He's bringing something fresh in. He's saying, I want you to love one another. Not with a selfish love. I'm going to love Chris because I'm going to see what can I get out of this relationship. You know, okay, I love Johnny Gould because Johnny Gould, he helps me with a lot of things. And in a sense, it's a very selfish sort of a thing. But if that was the only reason I love Johnny, I'd be in trouble. I just want to love somebody for what I can get out of them. He said, I want you to love one another as I have loved you. And what he's trying to do is try to break down that self-centeredness that's in mankind and produce a new kind of love. A totally something fresh where we're going to love people, not for what I can get out of them, but I want to love them because I want to love them because I want to just be their friend. I want to be able to help them. I want to be able to serve them. I want to be able to do whatever I can for them. And so he's bringing in a whole new concept of love. I want you to learn to love as I have loved you. And that's where the Bible, the scripture here, for God so loved the world that he gave. In other words, understanding that Jesus came, this love, he died for us. He gave himself for us. He sacrificed, he emptied himself. And there's so much that you could talk about from where Jesus was, from where Jesus came to this planet, by giving away so much of the privileges and so much of what he had in glory to come down and walk on this planet where he'd be despised, where he'd be rejected, where he's going to be. But he said, I'm going to come and I'm going to love them anyhow. Even on the cross of Calvary, he cried, the last words was, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And so he was displaying it. He said, I want my church, I want my people to understand when they're born again that something's going to happen to them. I'm going to recreate something on the inside of them that they're going to be able to love like I love you. And this is not an easy thing to do because our human nature, the nature of man, is very, very self-centered. And we want just our own way. We want our own will. We want everybody just to do things for us. And so now, if we're going to really, really break through and become the example that God wants us to be, we've got to understand what Jesus wants us to do, and that's love one another. He says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another also, that you love one another as I loved you. And also it says that you love one another, that you really, really love one another. And this really is a new word. This word that he's speaking about is agape love. And really, this word was never, ever used in the Old Testament. It was a different word for love over there. This word that he was talking about, I want you to love one another, talks about love and charity. To be able to love people and to be able to give to people and help people. First covenant was given by Abraham. It was called the covenant of circumcision. But the covenant Jesus is establishing is called the circumcision of the heart. And it's a totally different thing. It was prophesied way back in Ezekiel, 36:25. And, you know, as I was reading this scriptures and as I was studying this, it just started to into my mind, because sometimes as prophetic people get up and they start speaking about a move of the Spirit, or they start talking about what God's about to do, it may be 100 years away, it may be 20 years ago. It's prophecies that were spoken way back there years and years ago. But as those people spoke about it, people would have thought, what is he on? What are they talking about? But I believe that every word of prophecy will be established. Do you believe that? And we've got to listen to these words, because way back in Ezekiel started to say things that people around about them wouldn't have had a clue what he was saying. But as he prophesied this, he was prophesying what was going to happen in your time and in my time. Amen? Wasn't going to happen in his time. And it says, then I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean. And I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all your idols. I will give you a new heart, and I will put a new spirit within you. And I'll take the heart of stone out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will keep my judgments and do them. In those days, the Spirit of God only fell on the ministry. There was a kingly anointing. There was a prophetic anointing. There was a priestly anointing. And so right now, he's saying, I'm not just going to go on to those few people. I'm going to put my spirit upon all people. Nancy, would you just, for a quick minute, stand up and tell us about Sarah when she was on the floor with a black heart? Can you remember that?
I can very much.
Now, this story was a seven-year-old girl that would have had no idea what she was saying.
I think she was a bit older, but anyway.
You can.
Our granddaughter, Sarah, was caught up in the move of God in 93. And a lot of the children were from the school. And she was laying on the floor for quite a while, and I walked over and I said, what's going on, darling? And she said, oh, Grandma, Jesus just changed my black heart for a new one. And she was, like, tears coming down her face. It was just so precious. I thought, she's got a black heart, what have we got? She's just gorgeous.
Yeah, what I'm saying that is that, see, we are people of the Spirit. Is that okay? And God will do things sometimes in our lives that we don't even know. But there are things there that he's already spoken about that he's going to do them. You know, here is this little girl, and she starts speaking about something that God was doing that had been prophesied hundreds and hundreds of years ago. But friend, what I'm trying to establish, I suppose, is that we've got to be able to get a hold of what God is doing in our hour. And God wants to change us. And he says, I'm going to put my spirit within you. I'm going to build my church. This is a prophecy of the new creation he's talking about, and of the recreated human spirit. Ezekiel 11:19 says, and I will give them one heart. This means that we will be ruled by love. I'll put a new spirit within them. Means that the old human spirit, the old man, the old self-centered man, the real you, will be recreated with the nature and the life of God. See, when we got saved, we just didn't sort of, you know, join a church. There's something so dynamic and so mystical even that you can miss it. That when we honestly, sincerely, I'm talking about really, really allowing God to come into your life, somehow or other supernaturally, by the Spirit of God, he takes that old human spirit, he takes that old heart of flesh, he takes that old stony heart, and he removes it out of us, and he puts a new spirit within us, a new creation being that can love, that is not just going to be self-centered, that's not just going to be, what can I get out of this, but what can I do? What can I do? What can I do to expand God's kingdom? What can I do? It's not just here, you know, just bless me. But what can I do to be a blessing? How many people want to be a blessing? This new spirit, this new person now, we're being touched by the Spirit of God. Let me just say it again. The old human spirit, the real you, is to be recreated with the nature and life of God. So when we're there, standing there, saying a sinner's prayer and really opening up our hearts, you know, it's not just a parrot thing, but it's something there sincere. God, will you come into my life? I need you. Somehow or other, then God comes in and does a miracle in our lives. And this recreated thing that takes that old human spirit and now gives me a nature of God. That's why Jesus said, I want you to love like I love. God so loved the world that he gave. Now, I want you to love like I love. I want you to do what I do. And that's not an easy thing to do. How many people can say amen to that? What it really means is we're going to be ruled by love. Going to put a new spirit within us. We have now received the nature of God. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son to fulfill the law of the old covenant. The wages of sin is death. To bring in a new covenant when Jesus became a ransom for our sins. The Bible says, and now the just shall live by faith. Faith in the completed work of Calvary. I often hear some people say, well, I don't have to do this. It was all done at Calvary. It is all done at Calvary. But how many people know you've got to work it through? You've got to work it through your life. And you've got to forgive when you don't want to forgive. And you've got to love when you don't want to love. And you've got to go when you don't want to go. And you've got to do when you don't want to do. And you've got to be what God wants us to be. He so loved us. He did this to bring in the new covenant where Jesus became a ransom for our sins. And now the just shall live by faith. Under the old covenant, the word for love was Filio, is that, if I'm saying it right? Filio. Filio love is a selfish love. That's why Jesus said, a new commandment I give to you that you love one another as I have loved you. He died and he gave. God gave his son for you. Jesus gave his life for you. Praise God for that. Amen. There's no selfish thing in that. Jesus didn't have to do it, but he did it for you and me. How do I love like he loves? I want you to have a look with me in John chapter 15, verse 9 and 10. It says, as the Father loved me, I also love you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. Just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Love when you don't want to. You know, when Jesus spoke to Peter, and he said this, he says, Peter, do you agape love me? And Peter says, Jesus, you know I filio love you. And Jesus said again, Peter, do you agape me? He said, you know, I always filio you. And then Jesus says, Peter, do you filio me? And he says, yes, you know I filio you. Jesus was trying to break through something there, but Peter couldn't get it. Peter couldn't capture it. So he then came back down to his level. And he said, do you love me? Do you filio me? Friend, we can't be self-centered. We can't live like that. I'd like you to have a look at John 15 with me, if you will. I'm just going to read a couple of scriptures there. John chapter 15. Verses 11-13. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you, and that your joy may be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends. See, we don't really understand sometimes. Jesus came, when he came, he had to break through some strongholds. He had to break through the old nature of man. He had to break through the old personalities. He had to break through the old things that were going on in their minds. And he wanted them to understand that there's something brand new that he wanted to do in their lives. And Christians, people, we've got to understand that we can't live by the flesh. We can't just live the way that we want to live. We've got to somehow or other discipline ourselves and allow the love of God to flow in us. And we've got to show mercy. I want you to encourage you, and I'm actually will write a few of these things down so I can give them to you in a bit of a list. But I believe that it's good to have a little bit of a, you know, something. What can I do to change the way I am? And what can I do to help the work that God wants to do in my life? Because if I'm just controlled by this old flesh nature, then I'm just going to act like the flesh. But if I really want to take on this new nature and be somebody that God really wants me to be, how do I break down this stronghold? How many people know your words are powerful? And most of us are still in bondage because of our words, because of the way we speak. But when you wake up in the morning, you can look in the mirror and do it, but or you can just say it. Today, I choose to walk in love. What does that mean? It means if somebody cuts me off, I'm not going to blast them. It means if the dog barks, I'm not going to kick it. But today, I'm going to walk in love. I'm going to choose to walk in love. Today, I am fearless. I want to just make a little note here. The Bible says, perfect love casts out all fear. Fear is the breeding ground for intimidation. I don't know about you, but I was intimidated most of my life. But I've learned something, amen? I've learned to break through some things. Intimidation, shyness. Anybody ever been shy? Anxiety and many sicknesses. The things I feared, the Bible says, comes upon me. Number three, you can start to say this. Today, I have God's ability. I have God's love in me. I have God's ability. Today, I have God's nature. Today, I have God's nature. Today, I have God's love life. If you put these things into action and love on people, and I want to tell you, you'll see them change. If you work in an office or something like that, and you're an old grumpy, or if you're somebody there that's complaining, ever been with somebody that can never, ever see the good in anything? You know, you can be down the beach and looking at the ocean and looking at that, and you walk up to somebody and say, man, isn't this beautiful? Yeah, but it's hot. This guy, I was down there the other day, and I was saying, oh, man, this is amazing. He said, yeah, but it's hot. I said, it's going to be hotter than hell. He said, don't get me on that. I said, no, way. I just backed off. You know what I mean? Can you understand what I mean? Start talking differently. Start acting differently, amen. Look for the good. Look for something that's better. Look for something there that you know, we can, you know, get something out of, amen. If you're in an office or if you work somewhere or whatever it might be, you might be in a village and somebody goes past too loud or something like that, just act in love. I was glad I was preparing this message because we didn't have much space, but for somehow or other, people just thought that our little area was the walkway. And this lady walked up to me and she said, I hope you don't mind my children walking past I said, no, I said, there's no problem. I forget how I said it now. But it was true. No, it's okay, you know. But you see, I chose to walk in love. Choose to walk in love. If you've got somebody there that's cranky with you, something like that, go and love on them. Do something nice. Make them a cake. Don't put a brick in it. Don't put salt instead of sugar. But do something nice. You'll blow them out of the water. Because you see, I believe love is a key. Love is a key. And if we can learn to love, and if we can learn to flow in that love, and that, well, I think it's very, very important. You see, we can prophesy. We can cast out demons. We can do all those sort of things, move mountains. But if we don't have love, the Bible says that we're like clanging cymbals. So why don't we just work a bit on loving one another? Amen? I want you to love one another as I've loved you. I want to tell you, I want to see so much love in this place that we get oozy sticky. Eh? How many want to get oozy sticky? Amen. No, we don't want that. No. But just love on one another. Love on one another, amen. Love one another. Love covers a multitude of sins. Amen. So Father, we just thank you right now that we're just going to make some choices. We're going to wake up saying, hey, I'm a child of God. Hallelujah. We're going to wake up saying, man, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. But Lord, I have your love flowing through me. I have your ability. I can change. I can become a person that loves people, Lord. That neighbor beside me, oh, hallelujah. I'm going to make him a cake. Oh, Jesus. Father, we're peculiar people. You said it. We are a peculiar people. But Lord, you've put your spirit within us. You've taken away that old stony heart. You put in a new heart. And we want to work with this new heart. We want to work with this new spirit. We don't want the old man keep rising up. My God, we want to flow in love. And Lord, we'll give you all the praise. We'll give you all the glory. And everybody said, amen. Come on, let's sing a song before we go. Amen.